online professional development for English teachers. What is it that can be developed? Let's have a look. Does it mean teacher proficiency in English? Is this something that can be developed online? This is important in the recent context. There was a very interesting publication from the Ministry of Education, as it was then, in 2009. They carried out a survey of the English language competence of English teachers working in LSKE, International Standard Schools. But approximately 300 schools involved in the survey, divided more or less equally between SNP, SNA, and SNPA. And the language level of 1,374 teachers of English was measured using TOEIC. And what was found was 22% of the English teachers have a basic working knowledge of English, 4% have an advanced working knowledge, and just 1% has a high general proficiency level. All the rest, which is nearly three quarters, have lower levels of English, intermediate, elementary, or novice. And this is English teachers in SPE, which are supposed to be, or were supposed to be, some of the best schools in Indonesia. So it's clear that even among this group of teachers, there is a need for language improvement. We don't have any information about the language competence measured in the same way of teachers in non-RSPI schools. So part of my first question is this the sort of thing which online teacher professional development can help with? Okay. Or is it something to do with this? Stand up. Definitions of the four competencies which teachers are expected to have. Pedagogic competency, personal competency, social another way of looking at teachers' competence or teachers' knowledge comes from a publication by two colleagues from Leeds, Angie Malvarez and Martin Liddell. Can you go down to the one more? And one more for reference. So, according to Angie Malvarez and Martin Liddell in 2009, the teachers need three different types of knowledge, the three different types of teacher knowledge. The first one is knowing about. Firstly, knowing about the subject. Teachers are expected to know the subject, like we saw earlier. English teachers should know English. But there are other types of knowledge that teachers need to know as well. How is it learned? Not just knowing English, but how is language learned? How is English as a second language or foreign language learned? Teachers need to know about the institution in which they're teaching, its policies, what they're expected to do and what they're not expected to do. Teachers need to know about their learners and their needs. It's very useful if teachers know about professional organisations like TEFLIN and their journals. These are facts that teachers need to know. Then there are things that teachers need to know how to do, knowing how. Teachers need to know how to use strategies to support learning. Teachers need to know how to notice when a need crops up, or when learners are experiencing a problem. So teachers need to be alert and notice things that are happening in the classroom. Teachers need to be able to assess learners, not necessarily in a formal examination way, but by observing. Noticing and paying attention to the progress that learners are making and the difficulties that they're having. Teachers need to know how to relate to other people, not only with the learners, that's obviously very important, but also with their colleagues. with parents. I remember when I first began teaching in a school in England a very long time ago, we had a parents' evening once a term. Parents of children come to school and ask for information about the progress of children were making. The first parents' evening, I was terrified because I didn't know how to interact with parents, what sort of questions they were asking. It turned out the parents were very nice, so I felt more confident after that. And then teachers need to plan, of course. They need to know how to plan. The third type of teacher knowledge, this is a bit more difficult to describe. Knowing too, this is a sort of intuition based on long years of experience. When teachers know instinctively, at this point in the lesson, I've got to do this because I can see that something's happening, or I can see that a particular need has arisen. So, my question is, are these the sorts of knowledge, are these the sorts of things that online teacher professional development can help with? Okay. So, exactly which of these competencies or other attributes of English teachers can be developed online? Okay, next question. Why? Even if we identify competencies or other attributes that can be developed online, why should it be done? And for this, I've gone back to the proceedings of a meeting that took place at the British Council in London nearly 20 years ago. Just out of curiosity, to see what people were talking about at that time. This was a one-day conference on teacher qualifying at a distance. Some of the presentations make a lot of sense, even now, they're very relevant. Some of them are amusing in a way. One of the speakers feels it's necessary to explain about this new thing called World Wide Web. And somebody else talks about their first experience with email. So we can see that 19 years ago, the internet was something very, very new. But people were beginning already to think about whether there is potential in these new developments for teacher professional development. And put it a bit off. There are two comments in particular. The first one here that I'd like to draw your attention to, both by Julian Edge, who's a well-known specialist in teacher development, and he warned we must not allow ourselves to get trapped into doing stuff just because there's a machine for it. In other words, we need to have a good reason, good rationale for using technology. And we need to think about whether, even if it's possible to do something online, is it necessarily the best way, the most effective way? Next one. And the next one is also from Julian Edge. Go on. A bit more. Thanks. So the next question is there a risk that online technology may make teachers into passive or almost passive consumers of attractively packaged teaching tips? This question is from me, and it precedes the quotation from Julian. He said, the role of technology in teacher development must not be to deliver knowledge from the all-knowing centre to the ignorant periphery. He could already predict that there would be perhaps a risk that people with the technology would be perceived as the people who know about teaching more than the people who are actually in the classroom, who are actually the people. The centers of knowledge production actually are where the teachers and the learners are, and that is in the classroom. I think this is a very interesting question raised at a time when people are just beginning to learn about the internet. So, my second question is, so just what are the reasons for the benefits of online professional development of English teachers? Okay, next one. This is my last question. So how, even if there are things that can be achieved online, and there are good reasons for doing it, how can it be done? And I don't have any answers. I hope that people will be able to give us the answers. But I'd like to tell you about a survey that was carried out by colleagues in the University of Leeds and the University of Rockingham in between 2003 and 2009. They surveyed nearly 6,000 new teachers, teachers who were training to be teachers, and followed them through year by year throughout their teacher training, and then for 2 years after their training was completed and after they began teaching. And what I've done is take some of the information about what the teachers, these new teachers, said were most important for them in helping them to develop in the first 2 years after they were qualified. And they said, overwhelmingly, the most important thing that was helping them to develop was the informal support and collaboration of their colleagues. This was by far the most important thing. Some of them were teaching in schools where they didn't have this, they didn't experience this support from colleagues. But those who did receive it, those who were working in schools with a very collaborative atmosphere, they said that overwhelmingly that was what was most important for them. Some schools provide mentors. Every school has to provide a mentor for teachers in their first year before they become qualified. But thereafter, some schools continue to provide a mentor, some schools don't. The mentor is usually a senior teacher in the same school. For those teachers who had access to a mentor, they said that the formal support and the informal support from the mentor was the next most important thing that helped them to develop professionally. And then in cases where the head teacher was supportive, not all head teachers were supportive, many were, where the head teacher was supportive, that was the third most important element in helping them to develop. So these are all to do with interactions with people in the same school. Some teachers also took part in formal training that we would recognize as training, going to a training center one evening a week and learning about an aspect of the curriculum or something like that, or how to deal with the problem children. A few teachers found these training sessions to be helpful, but very few. And many of them thought that the formal training was repetitive, they'd already heard it during their teacher training, or irrelevant. The main benefit, if any, was meeting other participants. Like coming to a conference like this, probably the main benefit is not what I'm saying to you, but the talks that you have during lunch and coffee. Okay, thanks. Nearly finished. Now I'd like to tell you a little bit about a relatively new procedure in the UK called Teaching Learning Academy. The academy is not a building, it's a process, and it's managed by 8 universities working together. And what they do is encourage teachers individually to carry out little studies in their own schools. And there are 6 levels. When they begin, they can take something very simple, like how can I most effectively put illustrations on the wall of my classroom? Or how will learners respond to the introduction of a new book, something like that. At the 6th level, that's much more ambitious and may include national level surveys or something like that. But the idea is that teachers carry out a study, an investigation, which is new. It must be something new, however modest it is. And it provides a framework for teachers, actually not only teachers, but all staff in school, to test in some schools in Yorkshire. At the first level, what the teachers write is very modest, just a page and a half or 2 pages. But for them, this is it's an achievement, because it's forced them to look at something in their school, think about it, talk to other people about it, investigate it, and come up with some suggestions to improve very eager to carry out proposal. And then they have to present their report to their colleagues or to colleagues in other schools in the neighborhood. We've looked at different approaches to teacher development. The research of 6,000 teachers suggests that formal development activities are not attractive, they're not considered by teachers to be useful. The most important, most effective ways of developing themselves are through working with colleagues in schools. And then this strengthened new approach, the TLA approach, tries to build on that, helping teachers to develop themselves by working on issues in schools, not going to a training centre and listening to lectures. So my final question is, so how can online professional development for English teachers satisfy the requirements of being individualised? In other words, immediately relevant to the needs of individual teachers. Every teacher has their own needs. Collaborative.